assistant professor in the Department of Physics at SCAD Engineering College. He did his master's and PhD in the subject of physics from MS University Baroda, and he possessed a teaching experience of 21 years. So he is in this particular field of teaching since last 21 years. So sir, we are welcoming you, and I have to request you to enrich our students with physics.
At the outset, I am very thankful to the organizers, mainly GSBTM and SRKI. So it's a great opportunity as well as challenge to me to address to the gathering who is having the background of life sciences or biological sciences, and to reintroduce to them the subject of physics. That is why appropriately rather I have given the title of the talk as A Journey in the Amazing World of Physical Science. You already are expertizing the domain of life sciences, that's great. At the same time, physical science is also very amazing. Let us have a visit, rather have a journey in the world of physical science. It's a huge scope and excitement. That's why only in the entrance test, physics subject is also kept. It's more than 3 years of time for you. So you might be thinking, what is physical science? I'm again reintroducing the same thing what you have studied once upon a time in a history. Physics in the Greek word meaning it's a knowledge of nature. It is very important, it's a natural science, knowledge of nature. Everything that we see in our surrounding, everything that we see in nature is governed by certain rules, regulations, laws. What are they? They are very important to us as a layman or as an individual to know it. In school life, you might have studied physics with full of enthusiasm. But as an individual, it is a great concern of every individual to know knowledge of nature in general. I will not go very deep into the physics, don't be afraid of it. Not only that, I have taken very less text in my PPT, it's a colorful animations and drawings only that will entertain you rather. So reintroducing the subject of physical science is nothing but the natural science that involves the study of matter and its motion through space and time, along with related concepts such as energy and force. You already know this. Today you have to revise and recollect whatever you have studied once upon a time in history when you were in school.
So subjects like light, sound, electricity, magnetism, force, motion, waves, oscillations, etc. you have studied. These are the domains of physical sciences. Rather than subject to be studied, it is more subject to be realized. It is more subjects to be experienced. And we all as individual have experienced so many domains of physics in our ordinary life. The fundamental rule of observation is a basis of science. Science means observation, observation, and observation. You observe the same thing again, again, and again. Then you develop a pattern. You observe and analyze the pattern of observations, and from that you conclude that with what pattern, with what rule, with what conditions the same observations are being repeated. And this is how the basis of science works on. I have planned too much things. I don't think I can cover all, but I have planned in this presentation to touch some dimensions and universe, semiconductors and device miniaturization phenomena, what is sound, light, radiation, and many more. Let us see how many things we can touch upon. Forget you study as a student. You are an individual. Close your eyes. Look back to your life as if you are watching the movie. You go to the flashback. Likewise, if you go to the flashback of your life, because we are to discuss knowledge of nature. Nature you have observed from when? Prior to your date of birth. You have started realizing and experiencing nature prior to your date of birth. When we all were in the wombs of a mother, we were realizing sound. Yes or no? Yes, this is sound of mama. Yes, this sound of papa. We were recognizing it, experiencing it. Forget all science of sound which you have studied in school days. But what we experience is most important rather to us. So if you go to the flashback of your life to realize the knowledge of nature, starting from, let us, from date of birth, when you were born, you have started realizing, experiencing the things in your surrounding. Of course, maybe it was the face of doctor, maybe nurse, and then relatives, then maybe hospital, then house. Then we realize, this is not my old, this is not my world. Surat city is my hometown. Then we realize, no, no, no. Our state of Gujarat is bigger than Surat city. Then we realize, my country is bigger. Then we realize, entire planet Earth is my hometown. After visualizing this, we realize, planet Earth is bigger than anything else that we see in our surrounding. But that is a part, one of the spherical object, one of the sphere that we see, which is a part of solar system. So we are redefining whatever we see in our surrounding, whatever we see in our nature, and conclude that no, the planet Earth is bigger, but which is a part of solar system. So in this animation you see the solar system. So if you want to compare the volumes of various objects which are a part of solar system, our solar system, and keep them together, you will realize that it's not only the planet Earth, there is a Venus, Mars. Mars is our special curiosity because of various reasons. I don't want to touch upon. This is not right time to discuss about that. But India, along with NASA, have progressed a lot about mission Mars. But this is our curiosity. It is a knowledge of nature we want to discuss. Therefore, this is what we see in our surrounding. Then we realize the biggest brother is Jupiter. Big brother, Jupiter. Then Saturn, then Uranus. Earth is not biggest. Earth is small compared to Jupiter. We are simply comparing the volumes of various spheres that we see in the solar system. So big brother is Jupiter, but who is Papa? If we consider size of Papa, that is Sun, look at our size. Our size means our home size. Planet Earth is very small. So our definition of big, small changes when we expand the horizons further. So this is the complete solar system. If this is a volumetric imaginary comparisons, Earth is not big, Sun is very big. But picture is, this is not the end picture. There are other papas, other families. If you compare the fathers of other family, you will realize the Jupiter, the big brother, is only a one pixel in this picture. I hope you realize and you can see it. Here is Jupiter. Jupiter is somewhere here. Its volume is only one pixel. Earth is not visible. Our hometown, planet Earth, is not visible in this. we are making volumetric comparisons. But this is not the end of the picture. Picture to abhi. Look at the size of our sun, the sun to whom we do namaskar every day in the morning. He is only one pixel. Only one pixel. Big brother is not available, not visible. Forget about planet Earth, we cannot discuss. This gives us a broader picture of the universe. We say study of knowledge of the nature means at least universe. There may be things more than universe, we don't know. We don't want to talk about that. Let us talk at least about the universe. And we all know this picture very well. I will show you only the picture by pictures. The story of Big Bang everyone knows. I don't want to repeat it. And our point of view right now is to realize about the size of universe. This size. This size is somewhere around roughly 12 to 15 billion years. In other words, we have no language to realize this magnitude. I have written 1 billion year is equal to 9.4 into 10 to the power 24 meters. But what does it mean? It's very difficult for us to imagine, experience and realize. It's a huge. So after having known this much about universe, let us have a journey of mapped universe. This is not my video. I got it from YouTube. It's a courtesy by American Museum and Natural History. Look at this video very carefully. It's a 5 minutes video. This is rather more appropriate journey about the universe. Once we realize the broader aspect about the universe, the journey starts from here. That is Himalayas range. Tibet. As if we are in a spacecraft and traveling in a universe, what we can observe. We have tried to show you. This is our hometown, planet Earth. But now we realize the size of planet Earth. These are the ranges of various artificial satellites. The orbit of a moon. And this is the orbit of a planet, various planets of the solar system. When you go to the space, the real brightness of the sun can be seen like this. These are the Milky Way galaxies. The other galaxies which are nearby region. The galaxies that we have mapped so far are only seen in this video. So the real mapping of universe that is known today, they have tried to show in this video. The farthest objects are quasars. This is the picture of the universe. Now the return journey. Return back to Himalayas range. Same the orbits of various other objects of solar systems. This is our orbit. Back to home. Back to country. So, it's a realization of what we are supposed to observe in context to existence of nature. It's not only that what is available on the planet Earth. It's many more than, much more than that. So, we need to explore entire universe. I'm just cutting down this video. But this existent planet Earth, which is realized after billion years of time through these 8 steps, the first one is very well known, Big Bang, and then star formation, then supernova explosion, then solar nebula condenses, sun and planetary rings, others are formed, then Earth which is formed, then core forms, ocean and atmosphere, etc. came into the existence. So these are the sequential 8 steps by which the existence planet Earth came into the picture. Then being a human, we have tried to explore everything available on the planet Earth. And as on date, we are aware that this is the periodic table where all these elements are very, very well known to us in context to everything. So this is the knowledge we have explored regarding the physical matter that we have seen on the planet Earth.
So after having a very nice journey of universe, we have realized that whatever we have in our direct surrounding on planet Earth is explored and very systematically, in a very organized way, is well arranged, all elements in this periodic table. Thanks to Dmitry Mendeleev, and we all know these elements, how systematically they are organized. So this is now known physical world for us. If you go to the deeper side of matter, normally what we see in our surrounding, matters have normally 3 states. Solid, liquid, and gas. We don't talk about plasma right now. When we talk about solids, what you see is a regular, systematic, atomic arrangements that is observed in a crystal. There is a crystalline state and amorphous state we have studied earlier. The definition of crystal is regular, periodic arrangement of the atoms in 3 dimensions. So that is what you observe here. One atom, another atom, third atom, and so on. It is systematically arranged. And that constitute crystal structure. It is more specifically said as lattice arrangements. and you have studied much in deeper various pattern which is possible to arrange the atoms in various ways and means, and that is more described in detail by Breivik's Ledi system. We have studied Miller, Breivik's Ledi system, etc. So there are 14 various ways and means by which various such type of atomic arrangements is possible. These are known as Breivik's Ledi systems. If you recollect these systems, I would like to put one simple MCQ, whether you have recollected this or not. The MCQ is very simple. It was taken 2009. Coordination number in simple cubic structure is what? 1, 2, 3 or 6. How many of you are agreed that coordination number is 1? Fine. Only 3. How many of you believe that second option B, that is coordination number is 2? How many of you agree? No one. The third option, how many of you agree with the third option? No one want to reply. Then fourth option D is 6. How many of you agree with the fourth option? 7, 8. Okay, fine. Many of you are reluctant to respond. You simply have to respond by raising your hand. If it is wrong, nothing will happen. It's more than 3 years of time which you have studied physics before 3 years. You may forget. Well, the real answer is 6. Be happy. Question comes, why? The total number, see, coordination number, first we have to see. Let me go back to the earlier slide. This lattice arrangement or systematic pattern of atomic arrangements in a crystal gives us very clear-cut understanding about arrangement of atoms and how many number of atoms are existing in their neighborhood. Neighborhood means what? Wherever you are sitting in a systematically in a chair, wherever you are, how many neighbors you have? One on the left hand side, another is on the right hand side. So two neighbors you have. So you are directly in contact with at least two neighbors. It can be considered as your coordination number is 2. You are living in a row house. You have only two neighbors. So you are in contact with the two. So in that condition, your coordination number is 2. In such type of simple, our question is related to simple cubic structure. I have shown you the model also. In MCQ exam, this model, they don't print it. It's a simple cubic structure. So how many possible number of atoms are in direct? Suppose I am an atom, then I will have one atom on my left hand side, one atom on my right hand side, one atom in front, one on the back, one at the top, another at the bottom. So total, I will be in touch, in contact with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. 6 atoms. So 6 atoms are in my neighborhood, and therefore the coordination number is 6, and therefore 6 is the right answer. Not only coordination number, but number of atoms per unit cell. Many times MCQ may come related to the number of atoms per unit cell. You have simple cubic structure, you know all structures, you know simple cubic, base-centered cubic, then face-centered cubic and other structures. But let us begin with the simplest model. If you have such a type of picture where it is structure of simple unit cell, simple cubic, then each atom constitute 1/8 volume within unit cell. Yes or no? 1/8 volume within a unit cell. So 1/8 multiplied by total number of atoms in a unit cell, which are 8. So 1/8 multiplied by 8. So total number of atoms in a unit cell, you can count like that. But suppose, assume in a such a type of crystal structure, if there is some atom at the center, this existence of 8 atoms at the corner of the cubes are there. But in addition to these 8 atoms at the corners of the simple cubic structure, if you have one more ball or atom at the center of the unit cell, then total number of atoms per unit cell will be 2. 1 by 8 multiplied by 8 plus 1 more at the center. Now I am changing the structure from BCC to suppose FCC. You know FCC. Face centered cubic structure. Face centered cubic structure means in this type of atomic arrangements of the unit cell, how many faces are there to a cube? How many faces are there to a cube? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, how many? 6. Now assume to all 6, suppose, assume to all such 6 faces, there is one atom which is contributing 1 by 2, 1 half to the one face. This is the wall. This is one face. Then one half portion of the atom is here. One half on the other side of the wall of the hall. One half here. One half there. One half at the top. One half at the bottom face. So now tell me, what will be the number of atoms per unit cell under such circumstances? It is an imaginary question. Hello? You have to respond. See, one atom for all 8 which are located at the corners of the cubic structure, that will constitute 1 by 8 multiplied by 8 is equal to one atom, one complete atom, plus 1 half plus 1 half, 1 half plus 1 half, 2, 1 half plus 1 half, 3. So 3 plus 1 for the corners, so 4. So you have to imagine in a 3 dimension. Unless you don't imagine a given task in 3 dimension, you don't come to a conclusion. In this case, sometimes percentage of the void, percentage of the space, you know void, empty space is called void. That is also asked sometimes. So this you need to exercise more. Today only some glimpses will be given. So we have seen so many elements we have discovered and which are so systematically arranged in a periodic table. But ultimately everything constitutes of an atom or a molecule. You take the tiniest part of any element, you will come to one end, that is either atom or a molecule. Not only that, you also know the structure of an atom. You have studied structure of an atom. Bohr's atomic model, you know. I have taken purposefully this very important slide that shows you the structure of silicon at the center and boron and antimony. These are very valued, very important elements that has changed our lives like anything. I hope you understand what I say. If I talk about germanium or silicon, they are tetravalent in nature, you know that. Tetra means 4, tetravalent means 4 electrons on the outermost orbit. See, it is written 14, so you know 2, the numbers of electrons possible in various orbits, 2, 8, 18 and so on. So it's a 14 number, so 2, 8 plus 4. So in the outermost orbit, there are 4 electrons. That is called tetravalent in nature. Purposefully, another is a boron, which is trivalent in nature. 3. Another one is antimony, pentavalent in nature. these are just one of the element available out of so many elements we have seen in the periodic table. But see, how do we explore various items? The silicon or germanium is a semiconductor. You have studied band model of solids, you know there are certain which are conductors, there are certain materials which are insulators, there are certain materials which are semiconductors, you also know superconductors. If you realize through the band model of solids, so in case of conductors, two bands, which two bands I am talking about? Valence band and conduction band. These two bands are overlapped in case of conductors. So in the overlapped region, there are free number of electrons which are free to move within the metals, you know that. In case of semiconductor material, these two bands are separated, there is some gap. That gap is known as what? Forbidden gap. This gap is nearly of the order of 1 electron volt in general. These are semiconductor material. These are neither conductors nor insulators. And now there is a third type, which are insulators, where this gap is very, very large. Very, very large, nearly of the order of 10 electron volt. So to conduct this material, you have to apply more than 10 electron volt of energy externally. So therefore, they are not participative electronically. Therefore, they are insulators. But semiconductors are very interesting. They are neither conductors nor insulators in between. They partially behave as a conductor sometimes, as insulator sometimes. But there are two types, you know, intrinsic semiconductor and extrinsic semiconductor. Intrinsic semiconductors are pure semiconductor materials. Suppose I talk about silicon or germanium in a purest form, in tetravalent nature, is called intrinsic semiconductor. But now the story changes. Intrinsic semiconductor, silicon itself in a tetravalent nature is not very interesting because it is not very much participative. Electronic charge transfer process is very limited in context to having 4 valency in the outermost orbit. Let us change the game of numbers in the outermost orbit. And that can be possible by mixing the pure silicon with either trivalent nature of boron or pentavalent nature of antimony. If I add small impurity of boron into silicon, so I am adding 3 into 4, so total 4 plus 3 is equal to 7. They require 8 number. Now they have 7. So element with the 7 will be eager to have one more. They are known as acceptor material. They are eager to accept one more. Please give me one more. That is the attitude. If you add antimony, that is pentavalent, into a tetravalent silicon, it is extrinsic semiconductor. But the number game changes. 4 plus 5 is equal to 8 plus 1 is equal to 9. 8 plus 1 is equal to 9. So 8 is not a problem, but plus 1 is extra. I have something extra, take it. I have something extra, take it. So attitude is of donation. I am ready to donate one electron. So they are known as donors. So we create, adding small amount of impurity into pure material of silicon or germanium, and make them N-type material and P-type material. You know, N means negative, negative means electrons. Majority charge carriers are electron in N-type material. And P means positive, positive charge carriers. Majority charge carriers are holes. Now the story is very interesting. Earlier, pure silicon, not very interesting. Now this silicon, by adding either tri or pentavalent impurity, will become either n-type or p-type. So they have majority charge carriers, either electrons or holes. So exchange of charge carriers is now very much possible. The material which was not very interesting now is very interesting because of exchange program. Donors and acceptors, one is ready to donate, another is ready to accept. So charge transfer process is very much feasible and possible. This has changed our lives like anything. I am talking to you about every electronic gadgets we are using because of only this physics of semiconductor devices that has changed, and it is ever changing. When I am talking right now, some new research is going on. Let me take 5 minutes of time to explain you the expansion of this semiconductor device physics. Look at these pictures. The first one is a valve. It was called valve. It was a tube electronics rather. The first electronics was a tube electronics, old electronics. You might not have seen any tubes, or maybe a huge monitor containing some picture tube, or maybe TV of old age containing picture tube is a tube. So physical size is very large in case of tube electronics or tubes. So whether, if you talk about the radio which was used by your grandfather, it was a very huge size and immobile. Why huge size? Because it was containing so many valves into it, and physical size of these valves were very large. After the invention of semiconductors, that semiconductor what we are discussing right now, transistor came into the picture. Which transistor? Button size transistor. Button size. NPN transistor or PNP transistor, which is reduced to button size, that has miniaturized the radio, which was called pocket size radio. After that, IC came into the picture, integrated circuits. The third picture you see is the integrated circuit. The same transistor which was button size is now further flattened in a chip. You have the same transistor, function of the same transistor will occur in a chip. So further flattened, device is further miniaturized. This happened in around 1955. Then after, the journey has taken such a huge drastically change. The last image that you see here is all about organic electronics, but I am talking to you right now about this content that is known as device miniaturization. This progressment in this semiconductor device have changed every device and miniaturized it. This gentleman, Golden Moore, observed this progress systematically for so many years, and he concluded this statement that you see. He said the number of transistors incorporated in a chip, chip means IC, integrated chip, will approximately doubled every 24 months. Doubled by, what does it mean? It means we have the same small size IC that was containing one transistor. Now it will be doubled by 24 months. Roughly 24 months. It may take 18 to 20 to 22 months also. But by and large, he has observed this and given this rule that is called Moore's law. So earlier, there was a one transistor in one chip. Now hundreds of transistor in the same chip, same physical size, due to small scale integration technology. Then after, medium scale integration technology came into the picture. Now instead of 100 transistor, you have 1000 transistor in the same physical size. Then large scale integration technology came into the picture. Now you don't have 1000, but 1 lakh transistor in the same physical size chip. 1 lakh transistor. That is called large scale integration technology. Still man is not satisfied. very large scale integration technology, VLSI technology. VLSI technology is very famous. 10 lakh transistors in the same physical size. The computers that we all use contains Pentium chip, contains lakhs and lakhs transistors in the same small size physical size of the chip. So he has observed this golden Moore, observed this. This is Moore's law. It is true even in 2015. This is journey of all device miniaturization. See, at the bottom, you see the time scale. And here is a transistors per die. That means the chip. How many number of transistors are there? How they have been doubled after this observation, and this is with reference to every gadgets that we have used and seen. Of course, we have not seen 4G and 5G. Very soon we will be seeing 4G and 5G also. But 5 technology is existing today. And this journey is continued. Right from 1965 to 2015, this journey is true. This is a perfect evidence of progressment of semiconductor device. I would like to ask you one question. I don't know, my guarantee. You will be there after 50 years. What next in coming 50 years? See this journey. This is amazing. And all because the journey starts from the silicon. Trivalent and pentavalent addition in a tetravalent nature. Along with the suitable technology of creating IC. Then UVLSI technology came into the ultra very large scale integration technology is existing today. But tell me, the day will come, not devil, the day will come when there will be a problem of physical size, yes or no? In this hall is suppose having capacity of accommodating 200 people. Now if you want to accommodate 400, probably somehow you can manage at the most. But can you manage 800? Can you manage 1600? Why not? Because the question of physical size will come into the action. The same logic will affect this progressment. I don't know the future. But this is the journey we are observing. And every gadgets in our pockets of device miniaturization, mobiles and everything, we are realizing because of this journey. Now this has direct relevance with the semiconductor physics. Now, touching various domains, may this lecture may not be too much organized because just I have constructed after the preparation of only few hours. I couldn't get much time to construct this lecture very organized, suitable for the purpose. But I will touch various domains slightly. Sound. That sound that we have experienced right prior to our date of birth, we have realized, experienced. What is sound? Sound is nothing but a physiological sensation perceived by the ear. That is sound. Yes or no? Physiological sensation perceived by the ear is a sound. However, it is a state of rapid vibration, which is its origin. In Gujarati, everyone knows standard 5th, kampan paida thai to dhvani utpanna thai. When there is a vibration, there is a sound. Now these vibrations can be held by various modes. But you have studied sufficiently about the sound, its properties. How does it propagate in a medium? How does it propagate in a medium? How do sound propagate in a medium? Contraction and reflection, sanghanan and viganan. This is what you have studied. Compression and reflection. These are also known as longitudinal waves, stress waves, mechanical waves. I am producing sound. I am source of sound. You have receivers there. So I am producing vibrations in my vocal cords. So these vibrations are making progress in the direction of propagation this way. However, it is by and large classified by two categories. One is a pleasing sound, another is unpleasing sound, which is known as noise. The pleasing sensations are musical sound. Because it is having more periodicity, regularity and continuity in nature, it's a musical sound. And others, which is random, which is noise. So this animation exactly shows how do sound propagates in a medium. It's a origin is rapid action, vibrations. So wave particle vibrate back and forth along the direction of propagation. There is the peculiar character about sound. Then after we'll talk about light also later on. But this is I'm talking to you about sound, which are also known as stress waves, mechanical waves, longitudinal waves. So this is some of the particles of the medium I have tried to show with the red color. So that exactly shows back and forth motion along the direction of the propagation. But mind well, particle of the medium remains there at its mean position. So back and forth along mean position. They do not migrate from one place to another place. Particle of the medium do not migrate from left hand side to right hand side. They remains there. And that constitute the wave, what we known as sound waves. We know this. When it is sound, then there is a certain characteristics of sounds. We know the pitch. Pitch is something related to the frequency of sound, musical sound. Then you know the timbre quality. You also know the loudness. Loudness is something related to the intensity of sound. And very famous relationship that you already know about sound is loudness L is proportional to log of intensity I. Loudness L is proportional to log of intensity I. So K is a constant. This statement is known as Weber-Fechner law. So having known this, if you want to calculate, if suppose L1 is a loudness of a sound of intensity I, suppose, and L0 is the standard or zero loudness corresponding to the standard intensity I0. Now you have to understand once again, what is this standard or a zero loudness? First and foremost, this equation is very awkward to understand. Equation is say, loudness L is proportional to log of I. So the relationship is logarithmic. Now logarithmic relationship is very dangerous to understand, difficult. Let me test it. What is the relationship? Loudness L is proportional to log of I, I's intensity. Answer my this question. If I double the intensity, will loudness be doubled, yes or no? How many of you are saying yes? If you are yes, raise your hand. Fine. How many of you are saying no? Very few. Fine. I already said, this logarithmic relationship is very difficult to realize and understand. It's if suppose, L is proportional to I. L is loudness, I is intensity. In this condition, if I is doubled, L will be doubled, undoubtedly. Yes or no? This is not that condition. This is logarithmic relationship once again. Both the answers are wrong. Because it is, as I said, when it is logarithmic, see, let me give you another very simple thought-provoking case. Suppose, think of a situation where there is a lot of peace in this hall. Lot of peace. I realize this. But I want to make a very louder sound here. With the help of some, I am not so noisy, very musical. So I will use one trumpet. Why trumpet? Because it creates very louder sound. So if I use trumpet to make a sound, and that sound is suppose 80 decibel, you know, the loudness of the trumpet is decibel. I am alone making a sound through trumpet. But now, my dear organizers will come with me. I have another chair. They will accompany me, suppose. Now you have two trumpets, suppose, and we both produce sound with equal intensity. Equal intensity. Tell me, roughly estimate, what will be the loudness now? Any guess? It was 80 decibel earlier. Now it will be doubled. Roughly guess, how much? 160. How many of you say more than 160? No one. Less than 160? Higher than 80, less than 160? See, this is what it is difficult. If it is two trumpet, it will be 83 decibel. If it is four trumpet, it will be 85 or 86 decibel. Mind well. That is why our receivers are safe. Why our receivers are safe? Because of this Weber-Fechner law, which suggests loudness L is proportional to log of I. Log of I, logarithmic. I know you are poor mathematically, but logarithmic relationships are dangerous to understand. Alright. So when intensity is doubled, loudness is never, never, ever doubled. If two trumpets, 83. Four trumpets, 85 or 86. Otherwise, you think of all musical orchestra, if you have Western staff orchestra where 500 violins are, what will be the loudness? And think about the receiver's condition. You will be out of date. So this is the logarithmic relationship. So to realize and understand loudness concept, let us think of the first intensity that you just receive on this, receive sensation. See, these receivers has got lot of limitations. Lot of limitations. Every receiver given by Almighty to us has got lot of limitations. We have camera, but lot of limitations. We have receivers, but lot of limitations. What are limitations? That intensities are having lot of range, but that intensity by just I receive signals, just receive, let me call it zero loudness, and corresponding intensity is I0. That is called standard intensity, where I just realize some sensation. However, there are other intensities which for which I don't have any sensation, so they are not of use to me by this receiver. But some intensity I0, which is just touching to the drum, that is I0, standard intensity. Let me call as I0, and the corresponding loudness is L0. I have another intensity I, corresponding loudness is L. So I can write two equations from the Weber-Fechner law, that L1 is equal to K log of I, and L0 is equal to K log of I0. Can I write this equation? K is a constant, any constant. Normally K is taken as 10 value. So I can write L1 is equal to 10 log of I, and L0 is equal to 10 log of I0. Now, what is the perception of sound, physiological sensation perceived by the ear, is basically difference of these two. L1 minus L0 is actually the loudness that we realize. So that difference, if you calculate, is further modified as K log I upon I0. What is I0? Standard intensity or minimum threshold of hearing. One another beautiful word, minimum threshold of hearing, that is I0, and that is fixed for the humans. So this important relationship you have understood. Now on the basis of this, I would like to ask you,
some question. This is 2012 question, you might have practiced. Two sounds A and B have intensity levels means loudness, of 80 decibel and 40 decibel respectively, and the ratio of their intensities is what? 2, 10 raised to 2, 10 raised to 4, or 10 raised to 6? I would like to know your answers. You have to practice. I have taught you Weber-Fessner law once again. You know the equation. Loudness, total loudness L is equal to L1 minus L0 is equal to what? K log I minus K log I0. So using this equation you can calculate. I am calculating on your behalf. We already know this equation. L is equal to K log, ratio of the intensity. L, the bottom I0 is a threshold of hearing, the minimum or standard intensity. Now let us remold this equation into context to IA and IB, which is given to us. So I am rewriting the same equation for your comfort zone. Now I am keeping K value to be 10. So 10 log IA upon IB. K is a constant and log is base in 10, so normally it is considered as 10. For calculation purpose, it is basically a proportionality constant. 10 is suitable as log here base is 10. It is not, base is not written here, but it is log to the base 10. So 10 gives comfort zone. It has another aspect also, but that is it requires 10 minutes more and I have to conclude this. So these are the two basic equations I can write. Loudness A is equal to 80 decibel, which is given, is equal to 10 log IA, and difference of these two is answer. So what is the difference? If you calculate, 80 minus 40 is a 40. So 40 is equal to 10 log of I upon IB, and that will conclude 10 raised to 4. So your answer should be what? C. C should be your answer. Convinced? Agree? So this type of practices you can do at your home also. We can practice many more, but tomorrow onwards I will talk about sound further. Let us conclude this session today. We'll talk more about sound, light and other things, but time is very less, so I am concluding this session right now, having a pause. So let us conclude today to this brief note about some of the discussions of physical science. More things we'll discuss in the next session. Thank you.